Sorry. We had a wow and no one here. Alright. We know this part. The oldest understanding of chemistry was that we still have it, Panchabhutam, in India. And usually it's not Panchabhutam outside India, but four elements. And the four elements outside India were water, air, fire and earth. Akashatta, they didn't consider that. நம்ம வந்து நீர் காற்று நெரும்பு நெருப்பு பூவி மண் ஆகாயம் இந்த மாதிரி வச்சுருக்கோம். திஸ் இஸ் தி ஓல்டஸ்ட் திங். வெல் பிஃபோர் அரிஸ்டாட்டில் த கிரீக்ஸ் யூரோப்பியன்ஸ் ஆல்சோ ஹேட் த சேம் கான்செப்ட். எம்போடிக்லேஸ் ஆர் சம்படி ஐ திங்க் இஸ் த ஓல்டஸ்ட் ரெக்கார்ட் ஆஃப் தட். பட் கிரீக்ஸ் வில் வெஸ்டர்ன் ஹிஸ்டரி வாட் எவர் யூ டூ தே சம் ஹவ் ஃபைண்ட் அண்ட் ஃபைண்ட் அ வே டு டைட் அரிஸ்டாட்டில். ஸோ பிகாஸ் ஆஃப் தட் ஐ புட் அரிஸ்டாட்டில் தட். நம்ம வியாசரை கொண்டு போய் நிக்க வச்சுக்கணும் இல்லையா அந்த மாதிரி. ஸோ அரிஸ்டாட்டில் இஸ் த வியாசா ஆஃப் த வெஸ்ட். ஸோ வில் புட் அரிஸ்டாட்டில் தட். So they had this four element theory. Next please. So when people asked, first few questions that came were like people wanted lectures about gravitometry, this thing, the LIGO experiment. They wanted to talk about that and like that's too advanced. And second, people know everything about Higgs boson or think they do. People think they know a lot about the relativity theory. They're all like latest, you know, graphene, you know, carbon nanotubes. Today some carbon nanotube stuff is going on about Damascus steel. So these people are interested. Ask them some basic chemistry and they're like, So I wanted to bring chemistry in. Most of us really don't think of landmarks in chemistry. We are much more familiar with landmarks in physics, to a lesser extent with landmarks in biology. I'll narrate these two. These are the standard landmarks, right? Heliocentric, Western, we'll confine ourselves to Western science. Heliocentric theory from Copernicus, the telescope of Galileo, gravity, motion and optics explained by Newton, electricity explained first by, you know, Faraday, I mean first by Benjamin Franklin and a bunch of others, and then Faraday and then later Maxwell and others. Then the atomic model with Rutherford and Bohr, and then quantum theory with Planck. There's a whole bunch of other stuff, but this is kind of what the gets the glamour quotient. Next please. In biology also you have some landmarks with some names I'm sure are very familiar. Linnaeus, genus species naming, the binomial nomenclature in this thing. Robert Hooke, a colleague of Newton who discovered cells with the first microscope. Leeuwenhoek who discovered microbial life, including not necessarily just microbes but, you know, detailed pictures of very small things which are pretty scary stuff. Georges Cuvier is actually a French guy. Most people don't know him, but he is the father of paleontology and the first scientist who accepted or said that it was extinction and that it was widely accepted in the scientific community. He was a precursor to people like Darwin. So then there is Darwin. We'll keep the geology guy like Lyell and all that, but Darwin and Wallace, who came up with the concept, a good explanation for evolution. By the way, evolution as a concept existed for 70 years before that. But Darwin and Wallace were the first ones to come up with a good explanation, basically, natural selection. That is their major explanation. Then Pasteur, most of us know.
Mendel.
Yeah, Mendel with genetics. I'm sure whatever I list out, there will be some missing things. So some landmarks will be missing. Pasteur, bacteria and diseases, Watson and Crick with DNA. You're missing a lot of people. There's Carl Woese. Have you heard of him? Most people haven't. In 1970, he discovered a group, an entirely different kingdom of life. Perhaps you'll have a lecture about it. There's somebody called Lynn Margulis, who came up with the first explanation that is alternate to Darwin, supplementary to Darwin. He also tried it on. Peter Mitchell came up with the explanation of the oxygen cycle, so in breathing all that. Chemistry, what landmarks are there? We'll come to this. But chemistry, what landmarks? Can you name any people besides Lavoisier? What did Lavoisier do? Anybody know what Lavoisier did? What are his major discoveries?
Identified
the
combustion, oxygen.
If I say oxygen, does Priestley. Okay. So Priestley or Lavoisier, which one was it?
Priestley.
Okay. So what did Lavoisier do? What else did he do? Combustion. What did he do about combustion?
He also found out about hydrogen existence of, or he brought out existence of oxygen and hydrogen. Water.
Okay.
Combination of.
He said that water is a combination of hydrogen and oxygen. Okay, that's a good one. What else?
Disproved an older combustion theory.
Disproved an older combustion theory. Great.
and no change, no, there's no change in the
mass
when the material.
Ah, that's great. That people miss out. That is one of his biggest discoveries that people missed that out. So slowly we're getting it out. What other landmark scientists can you name in chemistry?
Mendeley
is the one guy that everybody mind jumps to. And he came about 80 years. You know the thing, do you know which year Mendeley came out with this periodic table?
Early 20th century, something like 1902 or something like that.
He'd be stunned. The year Gandhi was born,
1869.
Quite far back. So he'd done a lot of stuff. And, so anybody else? Mendeley, Lavoisier, Priestley.
Alfred Nobel.
Okay. Invention more than physics.
Madame Curie.
Curie.
Madame Curie.
Mosel. Yes, Madame Curie, Mosel.
Mostly, redefine
the periodic table with atomic numbers rather than
Kekule.
Kekule. Okay. So, you know, naming some people, that's great, fantastic.
Gay loser.
Excellent. Oh, cool. Getting names that I'm thrilled. I read a chemistry book a year and a half back, and a lot of people. Today is the birthday of Johannes Jacob Berzelius.
Avogadro comes
later, but yeah.
Vital forces.
But he did something else that we deal with all the time. I'll explain that. I call Berzelius the Brahmagupta of chemistry. And somebody wanted to know why Brahmagupta, and explain both later at the end of the book. Okay, so some great names. So we know a lot of chemistry names. And I'm sure Mr. Mohan is really holding it back. He's a chemistry teacher. He's the one who's very, very quiet now. So which is great. So Francis Bacon, I want to get this clarity about some Western science, Indian science, European science, and so on. Francis Bacon, who lived about, you know, the same century as Newton, about 40, 50 years before, and wrote, you know, some interesting things. He is the one who came up with concepts like peer review and objective fact discussion and things like that. He came up with the idea that three inventions or products kept post-Renaissance Europe, separated post-Renaissance Europe from all other cultures, civilizations. So he means China, Egypt, Mesopotamia, India, or even the ancient Greeks. What distinguishes them from these cultures? And his discovery was, the things he said was compass, gunpowder, and printing. These are the hallmarks of enlightened Europe. Differences from classical Greece, right? There's only one problem. All three were invented by the Chinese, and they knew that 500 years earlier, right? And they were brought to Europe by the Mongols. Whoever associates Mongols with science? Nobody, right? We'll see the difference. So, big difference. Now, 19th, 20th century, Joseph Needham went and studied a lot of science in China. We have a different understanding now. To me, what Bacon missed, and what most science historians even today miss, in my opinion, and I may be totally wrong, maybe other people have actually written about it, it's just maybe we haven't heard about it, is the importance of cruciality of glass. Why glass? Because microscope, telescope, that the two obvious ones, right? One looked into the small things, and the one looked at the distant things, helped. Those are things, magnificent. But we miss out simple things like flasks, jars, and tubes are made of transparent glass. We have had glass for 2500 years. In fact, India may have had the oldest glass. Indus Valley civilization had glass. We had small glass beads. That glass you can't do much with, just jewelry. Okay? China has had glass, ancient Rome had glass, ancient Egypt had glass, the Sumerians had glass. But not glass like the way we think of glass today. And that's the big difference. Next, please. This is what glass used to be for thousands and thousands of years. Until this period that you're talking about, until the 17th century, when the Europeans started fashioning transparent glass, which is when you had lenses, microscopes, and telescopes, and you had transparent vessels like jars. Next, please. This is Roman. This is the 1st century glass, that is 16th century glass in China. Both just curious about color, not more ornamentation and beauty than function for as a scientific tool. They are just beautiful things. Doesn't even look like glass. But, next please. Transparent glass is vitally important, I think. You can trap air in it, right? And you can see what's happening if you do something inside it. Second, you can observe other reactions, things that if you boil something inside, if you boil a liquid inside, if you put a solid inside it, if you put an animal inside it, if you put a plant and close the thing, you can see what's happening there. If you pour something, you can see the flow. If you can see, you know, Archimedes, poor fellow, had to go and, you know, sit naked in a bath. With glass, you can actually put several things and you can see them, relative density and stuff like that. Glass is absolutely green. You can understand the speed, you can understand, you know, rate of flow and things like that. Glass is critical to modern science. Plastic also is, but plastic is considered a villain. Glass, at least, is, you don't have that bad reputation yet. I think this may have set Europe apart more than anything else. I mean, you know, there was a book that came out which asked all the scientists, what is the most important invention in history? And very interesting answers came up. You would say something like, you know, discovery of gravity or... or printing press, which made us, you know, all able to read books. Electricity, maybe. Antibiotics, fertilizer, artificial fertilizer, which helped us food. Two very interesting answers. One was the discovery of hay. Hay made winter surpluses possible for horses. And so, able, you know, enabled empires to build at all times. Instead of confining yourself to when the, you know, summer food, you could have winter food. This is one proposition. The other was spectacles. Why spectacles, not microscope or telescope? It said that spectacles double the active life of intelligent people. Suddenly, people who are usually around 30, they start developing short sight, long sight, or all these eye defect problems. Some people develop it even earlier. And this hypothesis was that people who lived up to 60, if suddenly they could read, suddenly the smartest people could suddenly become illiterate because they didn't have glasses at the age of 30. That was a problem. Or visibility was very poor because they could. So that, you know, it was a force multiplier for human intelligence. So glasses, they said spectacles, they said was the most important invention. It may have been. I won't get into that. Next, please. We'll get to Lavoisier. So this is just the end of our teasing thing. We'll get that. So Roger Bacon, not Francis Bacon, but Roger Bacon, who lived, you know, the previous century, he said something very interesting. And I had to bring in one of my favorites, Genghis Khan here. Mongols succeeded not merely by... Roger Bacon wrote about the Mongols. Think about that. Roger Bacon wrote about the Mongols and he said they succeeded not merely by martial superiority but by means of science. It's a hell of a statement. They were eager for war but devout leisure to principles of philosophy. And recently, a very important expert in globalization talked about who are the forces of globalization. He talked about, you know, Rockefeller and Edison and people like that, and, you know, Rothschilds who expanded finance, you know, people who came up with, you know, Columbus. But the first person on top of this was Genghis Khan. The most important factor in globalization, they said, was Genghis Khan. Don't ask me why. Interestingly, Geoffrey Chaucer's Canterbury Tales, the longest tale is the tale of Genghis Khan. There is not one Shakespeare play about the Mongols. Only Italians, Egyptians, stuff like that, Denmark. But Geoffrey Chaucer, the Canterbury Tales, the longest tale is not about European at all, but about Genghis Khan called Chambus Khan. It is spelled as for Chambus Khan, but that is... So, time of break, think about that. I just wanted to throw it out to kind of, you know, morph your idea of what science is, which culture did what. We have a very poor idea of some of these things. Next, please. Succeeding Francis Bacon's ideas, a lot of smart people in England, and they had some unbelievable genius out there at the same time. Christopher Wren, who effectively is the architect of London, built most of the stuff there. Robert Boyle, famously of Boyle's Law, but should be equally famous for the pneumatic pump. He is the one who, you know, sucked the air out of things. Could do that. That was his major contribution. Robert Hooke, famous for his micrography, discovery of the cell. And of course, the granddaddy of them all, often considered, some by some people considered the greatest scientist of them all, Isaac Newton, right? Okay, did Isaac Newton do any chemistry? He actually tried more chemistry than physics or mathematics.
He was the mint, he was the...
Yeah, that was technical, technically he got money from the mint. Isaac Newton did more research in chemistry. What Newton's chemistry do we read? He was pathetic at chemistry. the greatest genius of all time, considered by some, was an utter flop at chemistry. What he did was alchemy. Alright? Think about that. Boyle air pump hook microscope we talked about, and our Boyle has a Madras connection. Why? This period, 1640s, 1639 is when Fort St. George was founded. We are celebrating that in a few days. And Boyle was one of the directors of the East India Company. We will not read that in the chemistry book. Right? Fortunately, we have Wikipedia. He was one of the directors of the East India Company. He was also a very religious person, which is the starkest criticism that you will hear of every Hindu scientist. Right? From Varaha Mihira to Brahmagupta to any Hindu scientist, you will say, first they will start with the prayer to Shiva or Brahma. And your Ramanujan will talk about Namakkal Thayar, dancing in his tongue or something. And this is considered extremely stupid. Isaac Newton wrote more about chemistry, about Christianity than he did about alchemy also. And Boyle was a very, very fervent Christian, but not a Catholic, a Protestant, English church. And he spent a lot of, he was an Irishman. He published the first Irish Bible, if I think about English Bible. And he tried to level best to spread the Christianity in Asia. He wanted to do it with the, via the East India Company. East India Company were smart people. They only wanted to make money. They didn't want to lose their business by spreading religion. So they didn't let it happen much. These guys had one interest. At that time, the greatest, grandest goal in chemistry was what's called transmutation. What is transmutation? Turning base metals like lead and copper and iron into gold. That was their great dream. This thing was called
alchemy.
And the way you could turn all these base metals into gold was by some magical substance called the Philosopher's Stone. And where have you heard this phrase before?
Harry Potter.
Next, please. Next slide, please. One by one. So, Philosopher's Stone you have had, famously. The Americans, typical brilliance, they turned this title into the Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. Because it's a wizard, we don't want philosophy about wizards. This is what science was called natural philosophy until the 19th century. Next. Which wizard in Harry Potter is famous for the Philosopher's Stone? There is a wizard who's... Yes. Nicholas Flamel, next please. Nicholas Flamel is the most famous alchemist of all time, supposed to have been born in the 13th or 14th century and lived until the 19th century or so, 600 years old. Some people think he's still alive. Okay, which J.K. Rowling brilliantly used. Which other famous book have you heard? Alright, so come back. So, the other genius, multifaceted polymath, who is also doing researches into the Philosopher's Stone, including Isaac Newton, which is what he was also trying to do. He was trying to do Philosopher's Stone with this alchemical work. Okay? Utter flop. Remember that. So, the famous people trying to do alchemy. Even though Robert Boyle had come up with some intelligent things, including a book called The Skeptical Chemist, and he had demonstrated the vacuum pump and the air and all that. Christianity objected to it. They said, there cannot be a vacuum. God must be everywhere. He said, well, tell that to the pump. Pope can say what you want, but the pump is, there's not much there. So, next please. At that point, alchemia is the name which had the Europeans had used to coin the word alchemy. What does the word sound like? Which language does it sound like?
Arabic.
Next please, one at a time. That's it. It's alchemia. It's Arabic. You know of two things which I mentioned some in the WhatsApp group, this thing. Two things very similar to this. Do you know what they are? Very chemical related stuff.
Algebra.
Very good. But it's math. Algorithm. Very good. Both nothing to do with chemistry.
Al-Qaeda,
you know.
They use chemistry more. They use chemistry more than anybody else.
Alkali. But math? Yes. Alkali, what else?
Aliphatic,
more complicated.
Aluminium?
Aluminium, no.
Aldehyde?
No.
Algorithm
and this thing, I'll come to that if you want, but. Alberoni, no. Person. Yes?
Alam. You got it.
That's it. Alcohol. Next, please. Alcohol is what they used to mix the powder and put it for your, what do you call it, this thing? Kandula mai powder. That is where the word comes from. Islam is supposed to disapprove of alcohol. Who is the most famous teetotaler today. You know, today there is one person, there is one very very famous person, there are two very famous persons. One is very very famous for not drinking, the other is also doesn't drink. Not today. Living today. No, not Modi. Modi is, yes, Modi India, but Donald Trump is more Muslim than most Muslims. But no, we'll go to that. We'll skip that. We'll go past the alcohol, which gave able to the word, please. Alcohol and alkali. What does that mean?
Alkali.
Yeah, not acidic. But what is it? What do we call? Do you know what the word, the cup, where the word comes from?
Ashes.
Ashes. Good. Good guess. Good guess. Next, please.
Graveyards.
Next, please. What we call, or the Europeans called caustic potash, was called alkali by the Arabs. That's where the word comes from. So, where else do you know the word kali? What is potassium? What is potash? No, potassium.
Kalium.
So, what is the symbol for it?
K.
Comes from there. Phosphorus is P, sulfur is S, oxygen is O, but potassium is not PH, but it's got an Arabic word. Next, please. In fact, in the 8th, 9th century, there were a bunch of Arabs doing this work. In fact, the most scientific, some of the, I won't go into the names, but one of them was the guy, even though he was doing very scientific work, he came up with this concept, somehow sold this concept of transmutation metal, and that stuck for the next 1,000 years. So that's where it comes from. Next, please. So, in England, Boyle, Hooke, and these other guys form what's called the Royal Academy of Sciences. With the help of what we are trying to do, Varaha Mihira Science Forum, without, you know, any royal help from EPS or OPS, what they did was they enlisted the king, Charles II, Charles II helped sponsor it, he funded it, and then he started the academy. And shortly after they started it, the AC is also struggling. Okay. Shortly after the British started it, the French also started it. In fact, there was an informal French academy going on before it, but they sort of formalized it with a person, the help of a person called Colbert, and then it had some of its early members were Blaise Pascal, Pierre Fermat, and Christian Huygens, actually not French at all, but Danish, I think, and he was one of the persons. There were several interesting people at that point. So they were all, this actually, we actually have a painting. It's there in France, and I saw it, this is on the internet. And that apparently the guy in blue is that Colbert, and he's going to the King Louis XV, and he's, says, okay, you can start the academy, and we'll call it Academy of the Sciences, and they were running 5 years, 6 years after the British Royal Academy started. Next. And these two institutions play a role. Finally, our hero of the day is here, Antoine Lavoisier, who would eventually become, he would try very much to become a member of the French Academy. What did Lavoisier do? Let's go into Lavoisier's story. Born in 1743 in an aristocratic family in Paris. So moderately wealthy. Aristocratic doesn't necessarily mean you're rich. It simply meant that you're in a part of the nobility. And not aristocratic doesn't necessarily mean you're poor, though mostly it would be. But so he was one of the aristocrats. Okay, but not one of the rich aristocrats. That would change. Next, please. He studied law because law was the IIT of Paris in that period. You had to, if you really wanted status, you had to go to IIT or IAS. IAS was what the status was 40 years back, right? 30, 40 years back. Even today, you know, Dowry, you get Andhra and all, you write a big essay about how Dowry is bad, get into the IAS and then charge the high Dowry. So that's a joke that goes around. So he studied law for social status because law and clergy were the only real things he could do. So he studied law and never practiced it. Okay. First person I started with, Gandhi, also comes like that. There's a bunch of people who practiced law and didn't do it. Studied law for social status. But his real interest, he was a genuine polymath. He was interested in everything. Next, please. So he also studied, next, please. Can go one at a time. Geology, physics, astronomy, mathematics, botany, anatomy. He studied all this, not necessarily as part of his college, but simply as a side pursuit. So while studying law in college, just to get status, he was studying all this out of pure interest. And who was he learning it from? Next, please. Nicolas de La Salle, a French astronomer whom we are not mostly heard of, but La Salle was the first person. He was the same period as I think a little after Captain Cook, the famous explorer Captain Cook. This guy went way south, and he went way south not for conquest, but to map the stars of the southern skies. They have not gone that far back. Most of the northern skies they had charted, but the southern skies, they are unfamiliar with the stars. You can't see a lot of stars. You can only see a particular range of stars based on which latitude you are. To really see like South Africa, stars over South Africa, you have to go say very far south. And England and France were pretty far up north. So he sailed and mapped the southern skies. 14 constellations in the 88 constellation standard chart today are named by him. 14 of the 88 constellations that you see in today's star map. We have frozen at 88, don't worry, constellations are not all that scientific. But constellations are there in the star chart. 14 were named by him. And look at the names he used. Microscopium. Antlia, he named one after, he was naming things after scientific devices. Horologium is what we call the clock, right? Pendulum clock. Callium, the engraver's burin, like a sculptor's device, right? So he was naming constellations not based on mythical animals and mythical, creatures, but based on scientific devices. This brilliant guy was the guy who was teaching mathematics and astronomy to Lavoisier. And Lavoisier very quickly realized something. There was a lot of mathematics in physics and absolutely nothing in chemistry at that point. So he said, and mathematics, you have to be extremely precise and, meticulous. You make one mistake, the whole thing collapses. No room for mistakes in mathematics. You can get away with a little bit in other sciences. So unfortunately, physicists have a very bad habit of contempt for other sciences. One famous scientist said there are two kinds of science, physics and stamp collecting. Consider all other science just as stamp collection, just collecting information, including Linnaeus and Darwin, is just stamp collection. So two important things: the fact that the absence of mathematics in chemistry and the importance of the accuracy of measurement. You want to predict anything, you better get all your measurements right. So two things he learned very valuable from La Salle. Next please. This is what most of the constellations look like. Even today, if you look at it, the star charts look like dog, Gemini twins, and all these other things, Betelgeuse and the Hunter and all that. Next, please. And this is what he named the constellation. This is what he saw in a constellation. He saw a pattern, he saw devices like this. Next, please. Another person who influenced him was a Catholic bishop called Abbé Nollet. T is silent, I guess, in French. Abbé Nollet was an extraordinary experimenter who did public experiments and liked to show people things in public, not just, do private thing. So he's a good inspiration for us. He was the first person to name the Leyden jar. Leyden jar was a kind of an early battery that was built in a town called Leyden, which is famous for it. It's like Manapare Murugu or Kumbakonam Degree Coffee or Vettalai. It's like Leyden jar is most popular manufactured there. So one of the experiments that he did, he was one of the things that he wanted, that human beings can conduct electricity. They have just discovered electricity. They are still, fooling around with it, trying to understand. A man in America called Benjamin Franklin had flown a kite. He showed out lightning is electricity. People had, people had just realized that metals conduct electricity and wooden things like that don't conduct electricity. These guys are discovering that animals are also capable of conducting electricity. And he did that by a very interesting experiment. He brought 200 of his monks, stood them in a circle, put one bunch of Leyden jars, ask one guy to hold the cathode, another guy to hold the anode, and then you could saw all the 200 monks, electrocuting in public, jumping like this. He did this for the King of France. The King of France got so jealous, he said, why should this be reserved for monks? It's very secular. So he brought his security guards, he lined them all up, and electrocuted his guards. So this is the kind of science that was going on. In fact, in the 17th and the 18th century, there were people doing tours. They would take 10-year-old boys, and electrocute them, all their hair would stand up on end, and then people doing all the stunts. And when they saw this thing in Germany, one English guy, and there's a German stunt maker who did this, circus kind of thing, where he had a man and a woman kiss in public, one is anode, the other is cathode, electric spark kissing and all that. He was trying to do this, and he said, this Englishman got jealous and said, I bet we can, the Englishman can kiss just as electrically as the German can. And so he tried to do the similar experiment in England also. So this kind of stuff was going on. So it's not just pure science, all kinds of stuff. He, on the other hand, he was not just a public, circus master. he was also a genuine scientist. So he thought of, he said scientists should think of themselves as a community, as a republic across nations effectively, not just to a particular nation. And they should explore the unknown and work for the public good. So not necessarily just for private profit and making this thing, but they should take the, you know, information that they get, publish it and educate the public. And this is one of his why, reasons why he was doing public demonstrations. So that was his thing. That's the leaden jar, by the way. This is one that's kept in the Franklin Museum in Philadelphia. Nole did a wonderful set of notebooks with very beautiful drawings out there. All of this is Wikipedia, so you can go look it up. Very nice drawings, very nice, you know, look at this lens diagram things where he's explaining how these things work, you know, tubes and glasses and how he is measuring stuff and, you know, burning something, seeing how the fumes come out of there, you know, using chemicals, demonstrations, you know, things you can do, very kind of very interesting stuff, naming them, labeling them so other people can understand, all kinds of this, and publish these books. Next please. Bernard du Jesu, so an astronomer and a electric physics person. No, Bernard du Jesu, who's a botanist, who studied medicine and then quit it. He didn't want to be a doctor. Just like this guy didn't want to be a lawyer, he didn't want to be a doctor. He had an official title of demonstrator of plants. That's one hell of a job. How do you get to be demonstrator of plants? But he was demonstrator of plants in the botanical gardens of France. He spent a lot of time taking Lavoisier around the suburbs of Paris and all the villages around it. And they were collecting plants. So he was doing practical, Lavoisier was learning practical botany also. And this guy edited a book called The History of Plants. So somebody had written already. He just, you know, kind of perfected it. So all kinds of other things that he was doing. All of them are very, you know, very capable, very influential people of his time, remember. And he was interacting with people in multiple fields. Next please. Fourth of them, Jean-Étienne Guettard, a geologist who was analyzing minerals. Geology was a very new science at that point. It's not stabilized quite well. He was doing this. Guettard and Lavoisier were afterwards appointed by the king of the government of France to do a first geological survey of France. And they produced a map together. He was driving this thing. And the first geological strata map of France that was produced. We don't think about that. Think that that is one of Lavoisier's contributions, right? But he did that. Next. So, I hope the whole point of this exercise was to show you what a polymath he was and how many fields he was looking at. So next, and we have two other polymaths that come into this. So he's learning from masters, obviously. Astronomy from LaSalle, mathematics also from him, physics from Nolet, and electricity and geology and botany. All of this he is learning. He's all of this, and you bring all of that into force in his next place. All of that force into his researchers as well. So he, the French Academy, the Royal Academy in England, would take you in if you accomplish something. When you discovered something and you're considered, you prove yourself as a big scientist, the Academy would make you a Fellow of the Royal Academy, right? Fellow of the Royal Society. The French Academy, on the other hand, it's a little different. You had to campaign. You had to, like, you know, try to become a member of the thing. It's like trying to get the member of the Music Academy or something. You had to do political stunts. You had to, you know, do connections. You had to do, you know, public campaigns and all that stuff. You know, சுவரட்டிலாம் போட்டு போஸ்டர்லாம் போட்டு பண்ணுறாங்க இல்லையா ஆல் தட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் ஸ்டஃப் நோ லவாய்சியே ஸ்டடிட் ஜிப்சம் பிகாஸ் யூ ஸ்டடிங் மினரல்ஸ் அண்ட் கேவ் அப்பேரண்ட்லி அன் எக்ஸலன்ட் சீரீஸ் ஆஃப் லெக்சர்ஸ் ஆன் த மினரல் ப்ராப்பர்ட்டிஸ் ஆஃப் ஜிப்சம் நெக்ஸ்ட் ஹி ஆல்சோ டிட் அ ஸ்டடி ஆஃப் சர்வே ஆஃப் ஸ்ட்ரீட் லைட்ஸ் அட் திஸ் பாயிண்ட் த ஸ்ட்ரீட் லைட்ஸ் ஆர் மோஸ்ட்லி ஆயில் லேம்ப்ஸ் ஆர் கேஸ் லேம்ப்ஸ் நாட் எலக்ட்ரிக்கல் ஓகே ஹி டிட் அ கம் அப் வித் அ மெட்டிகுலஸ் பிளான் டு யூ நோ லே அவுட் ஸ்ட்ரீட் லைட்ஸ் இன் பாரிஸ் The plan was such a wonderful plan that the Academy gave him a medal and then decided, okay, that's such a good accomplishment. We will now take you as a Fellow of the Royal Academy or whatever they call it. So he became a member of the Academy. Next, please. So in 1772, at the age of 29, which is really young if you think about it, he became a member of the Academy. Next, please. He did something very interesting. He brought shares in something called the Firm Generale. This, in English translation, is translated as Company of General Farmers. They were like really tax collectors. They were collecting taxes from other farmers and then depositing them into the government's treasury. So this was kind of licensed out, franchised out, kind of like your cell phone shops are franchised out by this thing. They were doing this and he was, you know, he was kind of a tax agent. You could actually, if you're a member of the nobility, you could get it, petition it, and was, and this was to be a big problem later on in life. Next, please. He was also appointed as the director of the Gunpowder Administration, the Régie des Poudres, which is the one France had an appalling shortage of gunpowder at that point. And he ensured, you know, gunpowder, he, you know, worked on it, became a master administrator. Like Newton was the mint master, this guy became the gunpowder administrator, made gunpowder very, very cheaply available, produced so much, but the people who benefited from it was not the government that appointed him, but a later person called Napoleon. He was the one who benefited most from it. So, but once he was appointed the director, he, you know, he was given an apartment in France, he had a steady income, he had a laboratory, he was still working for the government data, he's a workaholic, he's working all day for this thing, and all the other experiments that he was doing, interested in, he was doing in the evenings. So, you know, kind of like Edison in that sense. Next. He was also doing economics, by the way, which I won't go into that. Marie comes into his life. Marie is about 18 years or 17 years younger than him. She's 13 years old when they get married. You think 13 years old is one of my grandmothers got married when she was 12, the other when she was 15. This was very common in India, this was very common in Europe, not too unusual. And if you think it is bad that, you know, there's a 13-year-old getting married to a 27-year-old or 28-year-old, they were actually trying to get her married off to a 42-year-old. And she decided this guy was better. So she married him, and she is a member of the nobility, and she brought like a ton of wealth with her. So that, you know, added to whatever he was having. Next. Marie is, you can't just dismiss married at a child bride. Next, please. Not just the rich dowry. She also helped him tremendously in his research. She's one of the very rare people in that period where a woman was collaborating with her husband and doing work. She was doing literal, you know, she was a talented artist. She drew a lot of scientific diagrams. Most of the stuff that we have from apparatus diagrams and all that, we have from Marie's drawings. And she also translated English. She was multilingual. This guy had Greek, I think Greek, Latin and French, and that was it. She was multilingual. She knew English also. She was translating papers in English into French for this guy, which was very important because a lot of important research was going on in English. Next, please. She also drew a portrait of Benjamin Franklin, who was visiting France, and that portrait, I believe, is in some Washington Museum right now. So, at this point, chemistry had this some other couple of major things here. One was this theory of phlogiston. What is the phlogiston? A phlogiston is the thing that they came up with an explanation for fire. You take wood, it burns. When it burns, it produces ashes. Do the ashes burn? No. What happened? One guy came up with the theory, this guy, Yakim Becher, came up with the theory in 1667 that some combustible substances have something called phlogiston and the non-combustible substances don't. And when the phlogiston is all used up, it won't burn anymore. What is this phlogiston? No, just, you know, we didn't know how to, you know, how to explain it. So this seemed like a good enough theory and most people accepted that. And this phlogiston theory held on for more than 100 years. So this was his thing. In 1726, in a book, Stephen Hales, an Englishman, wrote a book called Vegetable Statics. He was studying vegetables, vegetable material, that means all plant life. He was burning things and, you know, boiling them and all that. He could see that some things would, you know, producing water. So not just vegetable stuff, but even other things, if you do something to them, they release water. Right? So there is water inside them and somehow the water comes out. Remember, they thought of water as an element. So water comes out, air comes out. So that air that is absorbed inside that material or water that is absorbed inside that material is what they call fixed air or fixed water. Not water that's free air or free water, but something that is inside something else. You do this, you boil it, water comes out of it and becomes some dry stuff. So that's something that they were, this thing. Other things are also absorbing water, absorbing air also. You could see that. Next, please. While this was going on, while Lavoisier was, you know, starting his studies, he was still, you know, trying to understand, some of his early experiments were with combustion. So he was dealing with this phlogiston stuff. In England, several things were happening. Mainly, next, please. One guy called Joseph Black. This is very, very early in life. This is about 15 years before Lavoisier starting to experiment. He had discovered something called latent heat. You know what latent heat is? If you melt ice to water, or if you boil water and it turns into steam, at a particular point, water just keeps absorbing heat without increasing temperature. Once it hits 100 degrees, you can heat it and heat it and heat it. The temperature won't change. So water changes temperature as you heat it from, you know, 10 degrees to 100 degrees. At 100 degrees, more heat you add doesn't change temperature. So it was holding that heat. and that heat is what he called latent heat. It's holding it up, and at the steam it would, you know, come up tremendous energy. And this guy was working in Glasgow in Scotland, and another person a few years later discovered the same thing, and he went to Joseph Black and said, do you know this? This water, this steam stuff, they seems to have some hidden power. Do you know this? And I said, yes, I discovered it a few years back. I called it latent heat. You know who the second person who discovered it was? James Watt. Collaborators. So anyway, James Watt did more practical things. Joseph Black settled with theoretical stuff. He also discovered that if you mix limestone with acid, limestone is calcium carbonate, if you mix it with acid, it generates a gas which he called fixed air. This fixed air, we are familiar with other names now, and you can see, you know, this is why chemistry originated in this period. He called it fixed air. This fixed air, he found out, was denser than regular air, and it would kill a flame. If you passed fixed air over a flame, it would kill it immediately. It would cut it off. And fixed air, if you put it in a glass tube and try to put an animal in it, the animal would start suffocating very quickly. So three things that he said. So this is fixed air, which is kind of a dangerous thing. If you bubble fixed air through aqueous lime, that is kind of a watery lime solution kind of thing, it would precipitate of lime, which will go back to that original thing. So you can, that fixed air could be absorbed by this and it would release it. So you can see that something is going on there. So he said that's very interesting. And he also found out that animals produce the same fixed air. But how can he test it? Because when you do that, so bubbling it through an aqueous solution of lime, you get that calcium. So animals are breathing the same fixed air. It's not a different air, but it's the fixed air. So he discovered this. And this was not used by him. A separate experiment would be done by somebody else. Next, please. This guy, the other hero of our talk today. He was born in 1733, 10 years before Lavoisier, and he died 10 years after Lavoisier, so he lived 20 years longer. Another polymath, brilliant, you know, multidimensional, like Lavoisier and Varaha Mihira, we don't think of as a polymath, but I'll come back to that. Next, please. Mega polymath. If Lavoisier was a polymath, this guy is probably a mega polymath. Next. He studied Greek, Latin, and Hebrew in school, besides English. Hebrew. Okay, besides this. Then he decided to study French, Italian, German, Aramaic, and Arabic. Next. So he was studying math, natural philosophy, which is what all sciences are called then, logic, and metaphysics. He was a school teacher. He was trying to be a parish priest. They wouldn't accept him because they didn't like him preaching at all. And he had a voice problem, kind of like I do today. Next, please. In 1761, besides all this, he wrote a book called Rudiments of English Grammar because he thought English people weren't speaking English properly or writing English grammar properly. Next, please. He wrote in 1765 Essays on Education, how English education people should be educated better. And in 1768, he wrote an essay on first principles of government. He wrote another book on taxes. He wrote a book on judiciary. Next, please. About too many things to fit. And in 1788, he decided to write lectures on history and then published that also. Next, please. And besides all that, he founded a separate church called the Unitarian Church and got chased out of England for it that later, but that will come to later. So, megapolymath is not an understatement. Next. And besides this, he also discovered oxygen. We'll come to that. While he was doing all this, he met Benjamin Franklin, the very famous guy who had flown a kite, who was another polymath, right? Doing all kinds of stuff. Printer, you know, this thing. Guys discovered oceanic currents. Doing experiments with, trying to get a government going, trying to write, advising people. And Benjamin Franklin advised him to, said, there's one thing even you are not doing, study electricity. So he studied electricity. And what, not only did he study electricity, he wrote a book on it called The History of Electricity, which was read later and stood as the standard textbook in Europe for 100 years until I think Faraday really started, contributing more. Alessandro Volta, Faraday, Maxwell, Herschel, Cavendish, all these guys also read or famously reported or read or understood electricity from this guy's book, History of Electricity. Next. Then he was experimenting with, he was doing all kinds of stuff. He got fired from this job, fired from that job, he couldn't get along with people. He finally became a tutor to the son of Lord Shelburne, who was one of the nobility there. He started with glass tubes and he was doing experiments with things called pneumatic troughs. Basically, an upside down jar with a little water in it. And if you put a pipe through it, and it will bubble air up, it will, air will collect at the top, the water will slowly reduce to it, right? And so even with that simple thing, you could do a bunch of experiments. So you add combustion and, you know, series of tubes. Next, please. Famous experiments. We generally don't think of this. He was not only doing biology, chemistry, but he's also doing biology. What he would do is put a closed jar, put a lighted candle inside the closed jar. What will happen? After a particular time, the candle dies because something happens to the air, right? Then he tried to experiment with just a mouse or a frog inside a closed jar. What happens after a while? The mouse passes out or chokes to death. Same thing with the frog, right? Then he put the candle and the frog in the same jar. Now they timed it. Clocks had just come in. The candle died out faster and the mouse also died faster. So they were both using the same air. It was his conclusion. So they are both using the same air, and when they put together, so then one day he decided to put a plant under this thing. He said, how long will it take for a plant to die? Right? He put a plant in a closed glass jar and the plant didn't die at all. 24 hours later, it was doing fine. It was fresh as anything. Like, what the hell just happened? Oh, this is also life. We know it's plants are life. You know animals are life. Understanding. Sorry. Okay, now I'll put a candle inside the thing, lighted candle, see what happens. Now the candle started burning longer. Candle started burning longer with the plant inside the jar. He said, oh, that's very interesting. Let me take the candle out, put a frog in. The frog also lived longer. The mouse also lived longer with the plant in. Then he put, you know, candle, plant, frog, you know, doing all kinds of experiments. They all do this thing. In fact, the candle seems to be flickering better. It seems to be glowing better. That's very interesting. Next, please. Then he did this famous experiment. You see the little cup with the red powder stuff there? That is what's called calx. It's mercury calx. Calx is, we'll come to that later. Calx is just a substance. They called it mercury calx. And he wanted to burn it. But he didn't burn it by, you know, opening a jar and then putting it and then putting a lighting a match fire and all that. That doesn't exist. So you use this, a burning glass. You focus the sunlight with a double glass arrangement, kind of like focusing a telescope. And that would go right through the jar and burn the calx, right? So when you burn that calx and you put a candle also inside it and start burning it, that we found out that that calx was causing the candle to burn really, 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 really brightly. So when you burnt that calx, it was releasing some kind of air that was making candles burn really brightly. Put the mouse inside it, the mouse started running like crazy. It's like Usain Bolt of mice, you know, it was like frisky and this thing and that. Next, please. In the 1774, he did this. He named this particular air. He said, some air is being generated. I'm going to call it dephlogisticated air. Why? Because that phlogiston stuff, right? So it's dephlogisticated air. It comes from the word phlogiston. So candle flows much better. Mouse, then he tried it himself. Took this ultimate experiment, right? You take this, burn this mercury calx and breathe that dephlogisticated air. What happens? He feels fresh, energetic. It's like boost, Maltova, you know, Kapil Dev. He's like full of energy. And he says, this is 5 or 6 times better than normal air. He's like, you know, sailing on this thing. So, you know, he had found a new air. He didn't know what the hell it was. And while he was writing this, he had a chance to travel to France with Shelburne. Shelburne is being his sponsor, whose son he was tutoring. And there he met Lavoisier. And showed Lavoisier this particular experiment. Burn the calx, it releases dephlogisticated air. So, meeting of the two great minds. Next. There are all kinds of experiments going on. I told you about Joseph Black in 1756 discovering fixed air. A few years after that, Henry Cavendish, another scientist in England, had discovered something called flammable air. This flammable air comes if you burn some substances and it releases something, and then that would burn like crazy. It would burn really powerfully. So he called this flammable air as pure phlogiston. Flammable air is what we call hydrogen today. I shouldn't have put that word hydrogen there. As I said, flammable air is pure phlogiston. But effectively what he discovered this flammable air. Joseph Priestley, besides dephlogisticated air, he discovered 7 airs between 1772 and 1777. Dephlogisticated air, nitrous air, acid air, and something called mephitic air. Mephitic air is atmospheric air with the dephlogisticated air removed. So if you take air, all the dephlogisticated air is removed. What is left? That is called, that doesn't sound like chemistry at all. We don't read things like that. This is the transformational effect that Lavoisier had on us. I'll explain why. Next, please. This is Pierre Simon Laplace. He is famous as a mathematician. You have heard of him?
Yeah.
Math, this Laplace, yeah. So, next please. Laplace was a lab assistant to Lavoisier. He was collaborating with him. He was one of the greatest mathematicians. He was a lab assistant, a helper, and somebody who is very, very good with instruments. Mathematical precision, not just theoretical mathematical stuff, which is what Ramanujam or somebody like that is famous for, or most these things are famous for. Remember Newton also, some of these other guys were just brilliant practical engineers. They devised unbelievable stuff. Newton invented the reflecting telescope, remember that. Brilliant stuff. So Laplace is helping him. Next please. One of the things that he finds out, one of the great discoveries that this guy finds out, Lavoisier finds out, collaborating with him, he was able to measure things very, very precisely and meticulously. Very critical. Lavoisier was doing measurements very, very critically. All chemists at that point were studying chemical objects by volume. They're saying, oh, this much volume is there, it's become less volume because of the density idea, right? Probably. And the grandpapa of them all, René Descartes, had come up with this volumetric analysis, and everybody was doing volume studies and saying, yeah, the big thing became small thing. So, and he's saying, look at the, you burn the wood, and you turn it into ashes. That becomes smaller, but let's measure the weight of that thing. And he was doing that with sulfur. Next please. Sulfur and phosphorus gain weight when burnt. Actually, they transform. But when they transform, things that are burnt, if they had phlogiston, and they are giving away phlogiston, they should lose weight, no? But they are gaining weight. Wood, if you burn it, the ashes are actually heavier than the wood. What is going on? Does phlogiston have negative weight? This concept doesn't exist. What is negative? What is going on? They didn't have a proper explanation for it. Next. Not only that, sulfur and phosphorus, when you burn them, they produce acids. What is called phosphoric acid and sulfuric acid. Next, please.
How can you figure out that sulfur or phosphorus gain weight? Sulfur produces carbon dioxide,
which
is not solid.
No. Next, please. You are the one from me. So he was, I'm telling you, he's measuring stuff. We'll get to the picture where he shows that equipment. So what he's doing, he is measuring the weight of gases. How do you guys measure the weight of gases? You take a jar, you find out how much gas is in there, right? Then if you something is absorbed from it, it's filtered out away from it. So if you have a jar that has something going out of it, if you burn something, it goes away. The jar weighs less, but there is nothing that was put into the jar. It's just that, you know, there is an extra tube thing that takes stuff out of the jar. So you take that, then you see that other substance, you weigh that also precisely. He was working with extremely precise measurements. So nobody else was working with that kind of precision. It's like Herschel's mega telescope. Right, when Leeuwenhoek's super microscope. People simply could not believe that such a microscope or telescope could be made, and he was doing it. They are doing it in their backyards. So he was doing that. He was measuring this, and look at what his discovery was. Always 1/5 of the air in a jar is being used up, and after that it would stop. Don't burn anymore. 1/5. You know what? What do you know about 1/5 of the air?
Percentage of
oxygen in the atmospheric air is 20%.
Go for one thing. You said, when you burn wood to ashes, the weight will increase, not necessarily.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, if you're, carbon dioxide may go away and
right.
What
so
you are measuring becomes important.
Right. He was measuring all of them in combination.
Mm.
It's next place. So this 1/5 of the air, so he's measuring the sulfur and measuring the resultant acid. And the result that acid that comes from sulfur or phosphor seems to have acquired that exact same weight by which that air is missing in that jar. That 1/5 of air is missing, right? That weight is what has been measured in the acid. He's finding this out. AC is really struggling, isn't it? Sorry, I'll try to finish it quickly. 10-15 minutes. So same thing with mercury calcs. Except with mercury calcs, he had very one advantage. Next, please. it's a fully reversible reaction. If you burnt calx, it would produce mercury. And if you burnt mercury, it would produce calx. And you weighed both, it was the same. So if you take the original mercury, right, it was, and then you get the calx, it was using up that 1/5 of the thing. So that 1/5 of this mercury combined weight was the same as when you burnt the calx, and it gave away this, and you got back the mercury. So it was putting that, the air that was coming out, we can separate it out, put it out. He is finding out that was exactly the same. And where he, and the way he was doing it is, remember, next please. I think without the equipment, this is some of the equipment you use, very crude looking thing, right? So you burn something here, it takes the gas goes through a tube underneath the thing, there's water in there, and then it displaces and it puts the air up there. So now you know how much water has been, you know, bubbled out, and you can weigh the whole thing totally, and then you can calculate all that. That is kind of arithmetic, but he was doing this. Next please. I'm showing very few equipment. There's a lot of other equipment also. So he carefully weighed all the components. That was critical. Next please. Next please. Accuracy learned from Lassalle. This thing. Crucial finding. No weight is lost or gained. There's no magical phlogiston stuff adding weight or reducing weight. Weight is conserved. Mass is not being added from some mystical stuff. Nothing alchemical is going on. It's all there. Next. This he called conservation of mass. Everything is only transformed. So things are only, mass is not the change. Volume changes. If you go from volumetric to mass analysis, you find out that the volume of substance may change, but the mass of the total things that are involved, reactants and, you know, final products, turns out to be the same. From this, you come up with something called the conservation of mass, which was also for a long time called Lavoisier's law. We don't study this as Lavoisier's law. We study Newton's law, Wien's law, Charles' law, Boyle's law, but Frenchman comes up with Lavoisier's law, we don't call it Lavoisier's law. I think there is some English hanky-panky stuff going on. Next please. He takes the next drastic step. He said this phlogiston theory is useless. Toss it out. It just makes no sense whatsoever. This cannot, it must be. And he comes up with what he calls the, next please, oxygen principle. When you burn the stuff, it generates acid. Oxy is the Greek word for acid. So this is an acid former. Sulfur, phosphorus, you're getting sulfuric acid, phosphoric acid, and so on. So the acid, they are acid formers, right? And she uses the Greek words for acid and gen, which is generate, that word, the root word is, that's where it comes from. Generate is, you know, born and all, right? So he comes up with that and he says, it will be called oxygen. And I'll come to that next place. So great insight. This is all kinds of apparatus that the, you know, Marie Lavoisier's drawings are like this. You can see how many tubes are going in, how many things you can measure and all that stuff. There's apparently a museum in France which has all these, several of these equipment, including, you know, I think even Cavendish and Priestley's, some of their works are also still there, though Priestley's house was burnt down by some of his political enemies that will come to that later. Next please. Incidentally, while Priestley had discovered this, a couple of years before him, a Swedish person called Carl Wilhelm Scheele had discovered the same dephlogisticated air, except he called it empyreal air. This guy called it, Priestley called it dephlogisticated air. At the first time, Lavoisier called it highly respirable air. Then he changed its name to vital air. And then he was going with vital air. Next please. Rose by any other name. Right? Next. He was rethinking everything now. First, phlogiston. Go. Then he repeats the Cavendish experiment, where flammable air reacts with something and it is producing droplets of water condensing on the air was burning and producing water. Wait a second. Air is an element, water is an element. How is this happening? That can't, there's something wrong there, right? One element cannot become another element, can it? So he's finding that. Burning flammable air produces, how do you produce water by burning something? It goes against all our understanding of anything, you know, of natural phenomena. This he found out, again, measurements, next please. Water is not a fundamental element because it's made of something else. It is made up of dephlogisticated air and flammable air, or vital air and flammable air. Next. So it's not an element. So element is something that we should be clearly defined. And decides flammable air will be now called hydrogen because it is a
generates water.
Water generator. Like the other thing, oxygen is an acid generator. We have a water. Next please. Hydro is water. Next, please. And he renames mephitic air azote, because anything, nothing can breathe in it. We know azote as what?
Nitrogen.
The English people came up from a thing called nitre. The nitre is a kind of salt. They get this this thing from nitrogen. So they called it nitrogen. It comes from that. We know azote as nitrogen. By the way, I think the French still use the word azote. It's only the, you know, the symbol is N, that we use nitrogen. The French, I think, still call it.
We use a lot of azote.
Huh?
Organic, we use a lot of azote.
Okay. Next, please. Next, please. So, major discovery. Water, air, and fire are not elements. It blows away 2000 years of alchemy. Right? Those are not elements. Oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen. These are elements. Sulfur is an element. They are calling sulfur brimstone of the time. Okay? Sulfur is an element. Anything that produces something that cannot be broken down into components is an element. Anything that is made of something as elements is a compound. He names them element and compound. Next. He decides that things have to be named properly for us to understand. If we try to work with this old stuff, it won't happen. Things won't happen. 1787, a solid, what, 13 years after, Priestley demonstrates dephlogisticated air, and this guy also reproduces it. He decides to work on a reform and nomenclature of chemistry. And he says very, very nice statements. Improving the language transformed the work into a treatise. And he wrote that book, Elements of Chemistry. We cannot improve the language of science without improving the science itself. Sir, the Vakya Padiyam of Bhartruhari will come in.
Converse is also true.
Yeah. Right, actually he says that. I didn't have space to put it there. Converse is also true. Next, please. So what else did he come up with? Some brilliant statements. All science is three things. Very brilliant observation. It's a series of facts, which is what the purpose of the science is. Next. It is ideas that represent such facts, because you have to explain what these facts are. Third. And words by which such ideas are expressed. What a formulation. How many scientists say things like this? What clarity? So now this is translated from French into English, but still we get the idea, right? Brilliant, this thing. I thought this paragraph really just, you know, jumped in my mind and said, wow, what an explanation. Next. Next, please. He quotes Abbé de Condillac in like the second paragraph of his book, Elements of Chemistry. And Abbé is using a book called System of Logic. And these are the phrases. Next, please. We think only through the medium of words. Next. Languages are true analytical methods. Importance not just of tools and, you know, things, but language also is an analytical method. Next. The art of reasoning is a language well arranged. You'll just look at that statement. A poet or a philosopher makes this, you'll be celebrating that fellow and putting it on his, you know, epistone, you know, tombstone, and you know, say, here's a scientist. That is Abbé de Condillac. This is not this guy. Remember, he's just quoting them. Next. Algebra adapted in every species of expression. Next. Another Arabic word. In the most simple, most exact manner. Next. Is both a language and an analytical method. This is all quotes by Abbé de Condillac, which he cites. The entire paragraph is there in his first or second paragraph in Elements of Chemistry. Who begins chemistry books like this? This should be in the front page of every chemistry book that we study, right? These two things, these two slides that are in this thing. And from what? From Lavoisier. We know the famous story about, you know, apple falling on Newton and this thing, but we don't have these quotes. We should have that. Next, please. So he added math to chemistry. Algebra, right? Next. What we think of as the chemical equation comes from Lavoisier. So not only discovered chemistry, not only wrote its first textbook, not only reformed the language, but added mathematics to it, and he came up with things like, you know, organic equations. Must of grape is carbonic acid plus alcohol. So this is a chemical equation that he comes up with, algebraic notation, and because of his mathematics. Next, please. Today we study things like this, right? By the way, Lavoisier only wrote in, you know, complete text. He didn't use the shorthand script. I will come to that quickly. Calcs of mercury plus charcoal gives you fixed air and mercury. And after Lavoisier, you have calcs of mercury is mercuric oxide plus carbon, which is charcoal, comes to carbon dioxide and mercury which we study in this form now, and that form was designed by Berzelius, the other guy I told you about, whose birthday it is today. Sulfur plus atmospheric air is sulfuric acid, not necessarily in that equation, but you get the idea. Flammable air plus dephlogisticated air is water. Metal plus vital air is calx. We today say it as metal plus oxygen is metal oxide. That's how we express it. The entire vocabulary of that science changes. Next please. He also did experiments with people. You can see this guy. He's
eating.
Yeah, there's a pipe in his mouth. He's measuring that. He found out that respiration is a form of combustion. You are using oxygen up. And he measured the gases and measured this thing, and he found out, this thing also. Next please. One of the most spectacular experiments, he burnt a diamond. He took this very large thing, like he used a small, burning glass to burn mercury calx. He took a very large gas. This was devised by somebody, and he burnt a diamond and said, look, what are you getting? If you chemically analysis, this is the same as charcoal. So, one substance can be the same element but have different forms. That is also something that he showed. Next. And in fact, the word carbon we take from is from the French word for charcoal, which is charbon. And I'm not 100% sure of this, but I think that is where carbon comes from. Next, please. The little Sanskrit linguistics, you talked about oxygen, hydrogen, and nitrogen. We actually use this ja. Ja is the Sanskrit equivalent for janma, right? Jan is the root word. Ja is how we used it. Jaha is male, ja is female, and if it's jam, it will be neutral gender. Okay? So, Shaila ja. Mountain bond, Parvati, Malayamagal. Padma ja, lotus bond. Vana ja, forest bond. That structure is very similar, right? Oxygen, hydrogen, that structure is there. Anujaha is after bond, with bond, right? Younger brother. Agrajaha is before bond. So you have that very similar structure. I couldn't resist throwing it because I also want to show you this other thing. Next, please. Next. Sanskrit also uses some of these words, and we will thank Balu sir for this. Next, please. Andaja. Anda is? Egg. Mutta. Mutta bond. Yonija, which is mammal. And Swedaja thinks that all the microbes they thought came from sweat. Just like some early Europeans thought it came from humidity. The humidity of the air. Indians thought it came from, what is that?
Sweat.
Sweat bond. So there are three types of in the scientific categorization, if you could call that, was this egg bond, mammal or yonija, and then swedaja. Next, please. And we also have two things to make Swaminarayan sir happy. We have these terms used in art also. Binduja, next please, and something called patraja, which is written in our some of the Vishnu Dharmottara Purana, I think, has it. This is the kind of techniques that are used in Ajanta. We use a shading technique called
stippling. Stippling. If you shade the dots, it's called stippling.
Yeah. I'm using the Sanskrit word. Binduja and Patraja. You put dot patterns. Next, please. I'll show you this picture. You see this little nymph-like person, the Bhutakana kind of thing. We put thick dots in the corner and very few dots in the center. The two-dimensional picture looks like a flattened, like a belly. So his belly comes from that. Variation in that this thing. Next, please. And if you took these elements, the trunk has got these lines like a leaf. That is called patraja. It gives you a three-dimensionality to the trunk. So we are using those in artistic terms. Next, please. So today is Berzelius's birthday. Next, please. I call him the Brahmagupta of chemistry. For what does that mean? Because he is the one who came up with the letter notation for chemicals. Single letter and double letter notation, like H for hydrogen, C for carbon, O for oxygen, and all that. He is the one who said, come up with it. He was, about 20 years after Lavoisier in terms of time. Next, please. And even the number notation, all the 2 and the 3 and all the little suffixes that you put, and they understood some of these things better. So, Berzelius and Avogadro, who talked about whole numbers, proportions, Dalton, atoms, all this other stuff comes later. He came up with these things on the number script for molecules. Next, please. Brahmagupta, why Brahmagupta? He is the one who first came up with names for variables instead of using actual numbers and constants. Next, please. So we write something like this, right? This is what we call algebra today. 2x plus 7y is 3z. We're using letters. Next, please. he would say things like tu kalakah, I'm very anglicizing it big time, tu kalakah savan nilakah is three shuklakah, and these are the names. What is kala is black, nila is blue, two blues plus three blacks or seven blacks or whatever it is three whites. He is using colors for variable names, unknown quantities. He was naming them. Correct, sir? Brahmagupta named it. So algebra really starts with them. He called it Bija Ganita. Arabs took it, they called it algebra because of Khwarizmi's book. Next, please. So, Rose Bainia, the name, should we call it Chennai or Madras? These are the names for compounds that were there before what's his name's time? Lavoisier's time. Milk of lime, meal of magnesia, caustic soda. We still use some of these names. Vitriol of Venus, butter of antimony, butter of arsenic, sugar of lead. You know, there are all kinds of weird stuff, weird names and, you know, magical, fantastic names. Fume of brimstone, all like, you know, poetic imaginary coming there. What are these things called now, thanks to Lavoisier? Calcium hydroxide, magnesium hydroxide, sulfuric acid, copper sulfate. We have very different name nomenclature. And that is primarily this guy's work. Besides oxygen, nitrogen, hydrogen, he identified 15 different metals. He said, this is a metal, this is, this is an element. Sulfur, he was the first one to recognize as an element. Phosphorus, he was the first one to recognize an element. Whole bunch of things. And then, you know, you had for the next 40 years, a whole bunch of Swedish and Danish and French and others identify newer and newer chemicals. They're naming them all down until Mendeleev came along and put them all in a nice little table for us. Next, please. Oh, what happened to Priestley? He discovered oxygen. His experiments was the one who came up with dephlogisticated air, like Scheele. But, next please. Refused to give up phlogistons, even after this guy's explanation. He went to his deathbed insisting on this phlogiston theory. Next please. Right, defending them. Wrote a book after Lavoisier had explained, after the rest of the scientific community had accepted that things were like hydrogen and oxygen. He said, nope, I'm in love with phlogistons. I will not give up phlogistons. They are the essence of my life. Next please. And Cavendish and the other scientists accepted Lavoisier's theory. He effectively, the elements of chemistry changed their minds. Next, please. So did the rest of the scientific community. Very interesting, sad part of the story we come to. There's a guy called Jean-Paul Marat. Have you heard of him? Jean-Paul Marat?
French Revolution is a great speaker.
Right. There used to be a statue to him. I don't know if this is the same statue that still survives. He had some very interesting statements to make. Next, please. 500 or 600 heads cut off would have assured your repose, freedom, and happiness. He was a proponent of the French Revolution. Lavoisier was an aristocrat, caught up 1789, the fall of the Bastille. 1793, a bunch of royals start losing their heads. Next. God has always been hard on the poor. Next. Famous quotes. Man has the right to deal with his oppressors by devouring their palpitating hearts. Bloodthirsty fellow. So what happened was, the statue was there for a long time, even after he died. And the Nazis came along and destroyed his statue along with a bunch of other statues. So that was Jean-Paul Marat. Marat himself did a lot of scientific experiments, tried to get it published. Lavoisier, at the part of the academy, said some of this is just nonsense. Either agree or explain, you know, to other scientists. Agree that this is right, explain why it is, or agree that this is wrong and toss it out. Some of his theories were right, most of his theories are junk. They were tossed out. He got into a big scientific, jealousy, you know, with this thing. He was one of the intellectual leaders of the French Revolution. He was the one who suggested, or he was one of the people who suggested that all the aristocrats should be, you can see all that. 500 or 600 heads cut off. They actually did that. They cut off 2,000 heads, right? French Revolution beheaded nearly 2,000 people. Next, please. Oddly, Marat was assassinated a year before Lavoisier was beheaded at the guillotine. Next, please. 1789, storming of the Bastille. Next. 1794, he was guillotined to death, along with 27 other people. Next, please. The judge who ruled it said the Republic has no need for scientists. The kingdom is gone. Or chemists. Next, please. He plundered the people and the treasury of France. This is a charge against Lavoisier. He enriched the world. He says he plundered the people and the treasury of France. Remember that tax collector thing he was getting from the farm stuff? That's why he is charged. Next. He is also accused of watering tobacco, which is a great crime. Next, please. Justice cannot be delayed. She was beheaded. Next, please. Then the revolutionaries got so bad that they were thrown out. The government sent an apology to Mary with all the possessions that they had of Lavoisier. Well, hell of an apology after he's dead. Next. Another famous mathematician, Joseph Louis Lagrange, that said it took only an instant to cut off his head and 100 years did not produce its like.
Wow.
It didn't. They never got a Lavoisier. They got a Pasteur, which is not bad. But next. So this is a summary of some of the things that he has done. It's not complete. He ended alchemy and began modern chemistry, came up with the law of conservation of mass, used mass rather than volume. This field is now called stoichiometry. To study this stuff. Extreme precision of measurement, he introduced it, rigor to chemistry, devised a whole new bunch of apparatus, which I am not going through, introduced the concept of a chemical equation, changed the nomenclature of chemistry, gave it a structure, wrote the first book on chemistry, showed that respiration is also combustion, and also helped develop the metric system that we use today.
Hmm.
And this is just some of the stuff. There's more. Next, please. This is a quite kind of a bit timeline of what changes have happened. And you can see how much is compressed in a very short period. We had old chemistry. We had some improvement in chemistry in the 8th century, 9th century from the Arabian researchers and Persian researchers in Baghdad. The 1660s, we had this concept of the phlogiston, which this guy got rid of. But we had identified some major interesting things. Carbon dioxide, hydrogen, oxygen. Look at what a very short period that is. But look at 74, 75, 76, 78. 74, Priestley discovers oxygen. Right? Discovers that plants are breathing and producing oxygen. And animals are producing carbon dioxide. This kind of stuff. 75, James Watt invents the steam engine. 76, Adam Smith, a very close friend of Joseph Black, who originally discovered carbon dioxide, writes the book Wealth of Nations. By the time, also the 20 years before that, cotton revolution had been going on. There are major inventions in cotton industrialization. Lavoisier comes up with oxygen, hydrogen, elements of chemistry. A very short period, you have dramatic knowledge. 2000 years of knowledge is being tossed away. Steam engine followed by George Stephenson's railway engine. Then you have Michael Faraday doing his electrical experiments. You have Humphrey Davy. You have a bunch of things that Franklin and others devised. Tremendous amount of explosion of knowledge, which in 1835 gave Macaulay the arrogance to say, come to India and say, one shelf of European knowledge is worth all the books in Arabia and India. That was his concept. Well, most of that shelf came in the last 40 years of that period, 40 years of that period. And in 1787 is this, 1783 he names hydrogen, 1784 one of my favorite Englishmen, William Jones, comes to India, founds the Asiatic Society, a different society. The world recognizes what Indian civilization is at that point. That lasts for about 30-35 years until Macaulay comes along. But that's where Macaulay's arrogance comes from. The last 30 years, not a 1,000 years of history. At least that's my take on it. Next, please. Thank you very much for the patience. I want to acknowledge the wonderful resource of the internet besides reading. I got to this by reading a book called Vital Forces by Graham Hunter, which gave me a lot of information. A very nice presentation on slideshare.net. If you just say Lavoisier and this thing, slideshare.net, you'll see a wonderful presentation. Some of my crucial stuff came from that. Hank Green has written a crash course on chemistry on YouTube. You should see that. This thing on Lavoisier is brilliant. It's only 10 minutes. Wikipedia came up with nearly half the information. And thanks to all the friends for helping arranging this and making, crowding out like this. Thank you very much.